How's it going, guys? And welcome back to another Q&A. Today we're joined with Mod Matt K.
Hi.
Mod Jed.
Hey.
Mod John C.
Afternoon.
Mod Ash.
Hello.
Myself, Mod Archie. And we also have a very special monkey hunting bit with Ian over there on the PCs. That's about the halfway point. But first, before we get into the questions today, Mod Matt K, take it away.
Hello. What camera am I on? There we are. So, two things we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about racism and bullying. We're going to talk about stream of favoritism. We're going to start with the racism and the bullying. Now, that's not something we ever want to see in Old School. It's not something the community wants to see. It's not something the team wants to see, that Jagex wants to see, and we stand against it completely. By standing up against racists and bullies, you make yourself a target. Because bullies only know how to do one thing. They will bully you. And if you're in the position where you're being bullied by these people, the teams, us as individuals, Jagex, and the entire community will stand behind you 100%. However, we need to look at how we can better deal with racism and bullying. Racism is quite an easy thing we can do. We can start putting in automated mutes so that when somebody uses a racist term, we can straight away mute them, get rid of them. Bullying is much more difficult. In order to track bullying, see what's going on, we need to investigate it properly. To do that, we need to look at our systems, we need to look at extra resources. Because as a team, we are 11 people. Next week when the new guy starts, are we talking about the new guy?
Yes.
We just did.
Yes. 11 people next week, and we're not equipped to handle the amount of bullying we see in Old School. So we need to start looking at how we can deal with that, how we can deal with it more effectively, not just for the most popular people, but also for the everyday person who plays the game and isn't a streamer, who isn't big on Twitter, who doesn't make videos. We need to treat everybody as fairly as possible. So next thing we need to look at is streamer favouritism. So streamers are much more visible. That's why it's much easier for us to see what's going on. And we've been much more focused on how streamers are dealt ever since Lyric joined us and he was surrounded by the little group of KKK people for his entire stream, which was not very good. But as we mentioned earlier, you're quite right, we need to treat people more fairly, more consistently, and that's what we're going to start to look at. We don't have the answers now, but we will find the answers and we will stamp out, with the help of the community, the bullying and racism currently in Old School and make sure it's not a thing. In fact, John pointed out something earlier this morning on the BBC website. There's been calls by big famous gamers to make stands on this, and we're going to do that. Chris, your turn.
All right, can I clap? No?
There we go.
All right. I feel awkward not clapping after such a speech. Let's get into the questions. First question. Anthony asks, can we have energy restored during carpet rides?
I looked into that. Since during the carpet ride you are delayed, we can't restore it during as such. What we can do is just give you a nice fat dollop of energy at the end of it when you reach your destination because you've had a nice rest on the journey. Of course, another thought though is, how many people like those carpet rides? Because I think they kind of suck somewhat. And what if we could get the graphics for it, we could try to just replace the animated ride where you see yourself drifting through the desert with an animated interface, a bit like Gnome Gliders have. Mm. I think it would be, well, less tedious, and it would also get right past this problem that you're worrying about. So if we can get the assets together, which is not an easy thing given the number of custom graphics needed for a thing like that, I would really love to turn it into something more like the Gnome Gliders.
Another benefit of that as well would be maybe we could get be able to travel between all the destinations from each other rather than having to go to specific places.
Indeed.
That'd be nice.
Yes.
There's a lot of no's in the chat.
Seeing some people supporting the carpets. I
like
the carpets.
Want the carpets, they can have the carpets.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
we can just give them a nice little dollop of run energy at the end after they've waited all that time.
How about while on the carpet they pass strange fruit plants which they can pick and get their energy back?
It sounds like some kind of computer game where you go along the platform jumping up to get the fruit as you go by or something.
Yeah.
Wait, this is a computer game.
All right. Next question then. Schism asks, can we remove the right-click trim option when the quest cape is in the worn inventory slot? He says it's not something clicked very often and you can still click it through the standard inventory.
Removing an option sounds pretty easy, as long as you can do it at the other time. Are people clicking it by accident or something?
I guess it's just, I don't know, inconvenience. One too many ops in there.
Clicking that rather than the teleport to the Legends Guild, I think it was.
Whoops.
That's fine, we can get rid of that.
All right, next question. Mr. Peeve asks, can you give us a ballpark area, or sorry, idea of the requirements for master clue scrolls?
Kieran's running that project, and he's actually just left, so.
He's coming back tomorrow.
I've had a couple of conversations about what he's planning with them, but I think we're taking them up into like the 80s, mid 80s, is sort of like a top tier, but it's dependent on skill. I mean, for elites, we went with like, I think 44 was the highest for runecrafting, whereas magic is like 67 because it's, you know, more commonly trained skill. It will follow the same sort of trend. So the amount of people that have access to those higher levels will be a factor in the highest requirements.
Okay, cool. Mr. Coogie asks, can you increase world hop limits to be doubled from 15 hops per 5 minutes to 30 hops per 5 minutes?
15's pretty generous. We would have to look at the implications that would be rather negative from that. I mean, nothing comes to mind immediately, but we have limits for a reason.
Might have to see what the authentication systems can take, because that has been a limit. And it's not the kind of limit where the players say, make it go away, and somebody waves a magic wand and it goes away. The system does not become capable of handling infinite requests as quite as easy as one might like.
I mean, it's still a rather large improvement on the minute it used to take to hop from each world. So.
Just a bit.
Okay, a lot of positive responses for that one. Good idea. Serwin asks, would prestige skill capes be a good idea for a seasonal dead man mode? For example, the top 50, 250 or so in skill / PKing / total from the last season would receive a cosmetic cape to wear in the next season.
See, I'm quite happy for people to have capes that they can wear in the normal games as well to show they've done it. Whether the community will be happy with that is something that obviously they will tell us. But there is something to be said for giving somebody who's played in one dead man mode season to get something which helps them the next dead man mode season. It's not the first time I've been asked about that either. Again, that's something we can look at.
Something that helps them or something that looks good?
Not necessarily looks good, but helps them was a lot of what I've heard. It's not just looking good. So that the more you play, the more things you get. Mm-hmm. So then equally, we can start looking at maybe sort of a bigger meta game for it, so that you earn points per season, which feed into some greater esporty type thing. So when other esport activities come out, you can earn points and you can build yourself up a league type system to actually earn points in your favourite method of esport.
All right, a couple different ways to look at that.
Yeah, as I was talking to Crumbs last night. He was streaming Old School, saying they've been working with ESL and coming up with these ideas for how we could sort of plug into their system. So we've got lots of different stuff that we can play around and try.
Cool.
Somebody was called it digital sports, which sounds much better than esports.
Well, someone should go and tell
me
esports. Worldwide.
Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
GWAP asks, can the healer hat from Barbarian Assault give immunity from poison when worn? Not venom. Just poison.
I like that. Makes sense. Interesting to see what the chat says, because we'd have to poll it, of course, but I think that's a perfectly sensible change to offer.
The combat system can distinguish between poison and venom at the time when you're getting attacked by the things, so I don't see a problem for us.
Okay. They seem to really like that. Wow. Nice. All right.
We'll get that one on a poll.
You never know with some of these. JMH asks, can you increase the Slayer experience reward from Vedion? It's currently 625 XP per killing a 500 hit points boss and 4 stronger Hellhounds.
Given that we did it to the Kalfite Queen, and Vedion would have had reduced XP for the same reason the Kalfite did, because it only took into account the final stage, I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah, I think it's already got a fixed artificial.
Did we do that?
We can take it up. Again, have to come up with an acceptable figure and pull it. But
maybe add the HP of the dogs.
Yeah, that would make sense.
Of course,
you
may not have killed the dogs, but someone did.
Again, a lot of support for that one. Good ideas already. Origin asks, can you make the unidentified liquid barrel in dig site fill all of your vials so it's easier to collect them?
Happily.
just treat it the same way that sinks work when you're filling a vial at them.
Yep, just make a nice, simple change. I can see why it was never done in the in the initial place. I'm sure the developer who wrote the dig site way back in 1942 or whenever it was didn't expect it to become an actual useful item.
Yes, he didn't see the rocks coming back in RS Classic.
But it'd be nice to do.
Okay. Scaper asks, with the removal of the QA job post on the JAGEX website, does this mean you have found a new QA, and when will we get to see this person?
We have.
We covered that.
Yes. That's not the person starting next week.
Starting next week's a new
artist. We've told them about the new artist. Yeah, that's coming first.
Yeah, we have the artist starting next week, and we do have a new QA person who will be joining us on June the 13th, I think is the current date. That might change.
We've got two coming, haven't we?
Yes, a couple of days before that, we have a temporary person coming to join us for the summer. We have an intern coming in to help out with QA, who looks remarkably like a rather popular member of our community, so I expect that to be quite interesting when we put him on stream. Yeah.
Looks like Zezima.
I'm interested now. So two new QA, one's temporary, one's permanent, and one new artist.
There's also another job about to go up on the website as well, which is somebody to help Ronan, which sounds really wrong. Sorry, Ronan.
Somebody to do some of the same things as Ronan.
An additional community manager is what we're also looking for. It should be up on the website in the next few days if all goes to plan.
If I get my way, there'll be a couple more going up in the next few months. Mm.
So team is expanding. I mean, you think about where we were, 2 years ago when there were three of us? Just after you joined us, wasn't it? So four of us. Mm. And now there's going to be 11, 12, 13, 14, almost 16 of us by the summer this year.
By the end of the year, I expect we'll be probably looking closer to 20.
Mm-hmm. Going to need a bigger desk.
Yeah, I'm going to need a bigger couch. I did ask
We need a different couch.
About getting tub chairs for in here.
Yes.
And people seemed quite excited about that, so we could see if we can get a more comfortable couch than this one.
Since the day I sat on this couch, I was asking for a better couch.
It's the way you sit on it, and this is kind of thud as your bottom makes contact with the not a cushion. Yeah.
I don't know whose decision it was to order this one, but I know James and Simon, when they were here, they were in charge of this room, and they weren't entirely happy with it, so I don't know who it was that made the decision.
Well, I tried spilling my tea on it, but someone just cleaned it.
It always looks so nice from the other side of the camera, that's the thing.
Maybe we should give it away to the community.
Auction the couch.
We could just say...
Even charity.
We could probably do that. I think they probably wouldn't want it.
Take a Jamor couch. Yeah. What couch?
It's been suggested we sign the couch. For the chat.
I thought the beginning of this was entirely hypothetical. I'm now thinking you're all serious.
Well, it's not our couch, so we can be,
We're having recently bought a very comfortable sofa. I can recommend some to replace this.
Okay. Sure. You need an awkward sized living area.
We've got a pole removing the couch, haven't we? Should we swap the couch out for something better?
As long as my ass counts as 1,000 votes.
Yeah.
Moving on, shall we? Let's go to this question from Elite Champion, who asks, can you make the rune pouch from Bounty Hunter tradable?
I think the nature of the Bounty Hunter store would kind of... It just makes me not want to do that, because for one, it does draw people to Bounty Hunter, because there's not a whole lot of reason to go there unless you're actually PKing. And so you've got those people that do want to get their rune pouches, so they will go to Bounty Hunter, kill people, or just buy emblems, which keeps their value up as well. I can't see it passing a poll.
Also, since the thing's storing its data on you, the player, not on the item itself, if you end up with two of the things because you had one and you bought another one, then they both link to the same runes, and it would be really quite confusing where you'd put your runes. So there's reasons we limited you to one of those. It's not like, say, the Soul Bearer, where the runes you put in that are stored on the items, so we can let you have lots of them and they'll just keep working independently of each other very happily.
Okay. Krieger asks, will raids be the only thing added to the Zaya expansion 2, or when can we expect the Dungeon and Woodcutting Guild?
The Woodcutting Guild should be out within the next couple of weeks. I think Jed started on that at the start of this week.
So that should be ready next couple of weeks, definitely.
The catacombs are a little larger. We're looking like a 4-map square kind of size of area with a load of new mobs to program test before they can be launched. So we're probably looking at the back end of June, mid-July kind of time for those. And with the raids themselves, which are going to be September time, there will be a lot of sort of mapping changes that you can see and explore, but they may not have a lot of content. We're looking at doing the river at the same time as well and maybe tweaking the coastline.
I had a request from a player today saying that the blue dragonhide body is really quite hard to get if you're an Iron Man, because it's not dropped by any monster. I've confirmed this is true. And it's like 71 crafting to make one. So it was suggested that if we're putting in new kinds of Slayer monster with new kinds of drops, we could solve that one for them, if we wanted to, of course. I was interested to know what the players thought of that.
That would be interesting. It's used for a hard crucial, and I imagine that's why they want it.
Yes.
There's going to be a chunk of players who are going to vote no for anything Iron Man related, but then there's a chunk of players who are going to vote yes for anything Ash says. So
I wouldn't bank on that. Although, if that were true. Yeah, so I see a lot of yes, I see a lot of no.
Exactly that.
Yeah, well, good luck with that lot.
All right.
A few suggestions about what we can do with Iron Men, too.
Moving on. Fluffiness asks, can we get an armory room added to the construction update? Be a place for us to display cool armor sets like bandos or our favorite weapons?
I think having them on display wouldn't actually be too popular because it would cost you the sets. And being able to take them back makes it a little bit more difficult. It's possible. Yeah. But certainly a room where you can store various amounts of armors so you're not taking up all of your precious bank space, I think that would be very popular. Whether or not we can sneak it into the existing plans in the time we have might be difficult.
Well, we could define a set of bandos as a set and stick it in the existing armor case.
Or that. It would be nice to have a whole armor room.
It would be nice to have something more visual. Yeah. If you're going to stick bandos in a POH, then it should look like it.
I imagine like a wall kit of AGSs and you need like 20 of them. Mm. As long as you can get them back.
Yeah. Sounds like that idea for the fence made out of the obsidian staff last week. that was a good one.
That's actually going to happen.
Oh, someone sent an amazing picture of it.
Mm. I mean, for the smaller items, if you want a scimitar rack, then you could obviously do all those without too much difficulty, and then you could do it for all the different sorts of weapons. You could have racks across the walls of all the different sorts of weapons that you have, which would look quite spectacular, which would be quite nice.
Yeah.
And the God Sword rack would obviously be the one that everybody wants to fill and still have God Sword sitting in their bank.
Yeah. All right, next question. Origins asks, he has a fire-making update suggestion here, actually. He says, farming lanterns that you can place near a farming patch to speed up growth. The length of the lantern's fire depends on the quality of logs you use.
How modifiable are growth cycles?
So at the moment, the timer goes every 5 minutes, give or take what happens if you log in and out. And if we wanted a patch, the one that your lantern is near, to run every 4 minutes or every 2 minutes instead, we'd need a completely separate timer, or we'd need to rewrite the existing one to run all the time but only do the standard patches every 5 minutes and do this other one every 2 minutes. That's a scalar job where we're rewriting the farming timer, and we'd better hope like heck that someone can retest the whole thing thoroughly.
But given the amount of no's I've just seen in the chat, I think we know where we'll leave that idea.
When the player, or possibly a different player, tweeted me that one a few days ago, the response I gave was, firstly, that about the timer, because it's still true whether you tweet me or whether you ask me on the stream. But I also pointed out that I could, of course, just program the farming timer to run that patch twice every time the farming timer runs, which would be the simplest way of accelerating it. But you'd end up with all your patches going, all your affected patches going at double speed, which I thought would be rather a big increase to the XP rate. The player was convinced that was absolutely fine, but I figured that might not be the prevalent view. Anyway, that's it on the farming timer.
Okay. Did see a lot of people not very happy with that idea there, but interesting idea. My Little Ultimate asks, can the Elite Wildy Diary make the drop rate of the looting bag 100%?
It could. It's not that difficult to get. It's 1 in 30 from everything that lives inside the wilderness.
I don't know. Sometimes I've got it my first try. Sometimes it's taken me like an hour plus to get it.
That's the nature of RNG, and that's the nature of RuneScape.
But it's nice to give someone a boost, I think, for especially the Wilderness Elite. Something as minor as the looting bag. I see that being a little bonus.
We could just make it happen as a guaranteed drop if you haven't already got one, maybe.
Okay, there's got a fair amount of support. We can offer that in a poll, I think.
I get what you mean, though.
Okay, moving on. Sloth asks, can we make it so that when the compass is right-clicked, we can choose to look in the direction of north, south, east, or west?
Yes.
Yeah, I think we have left-click for north only.
I wasn't expecting a yes there.
I wasn't.
Well, the engine support we got for making it look north can also do other directions, in fact.
So you're saying someone had the foresight to create a reusable command?
What they gave us was a command that tells the camera which way to point.
I mean, that's a fair point up there by somebody whose name disappears, like, why?
It didn't say.
For dramatic viewing experiences. maybe you're PKing and you see a white dot on the minimap to the east. You want a really quick.
So you right click on the compass, yeah. And in the list of drop downs, you choose east. No, that was south. East. Got it. Oh, he's killed me. Now I can see Lumbridge Castle, but no, I see the Lumbridge Gate. Keep on looking east. Yeah, this is a great update. This one, but we
really
can do it.
Terrifying memories. All right. What do you asks? Could fire making have purpose in the catacombs of Zaya? So he's got an idea here, saying perhaps you need to burn down barricades / overgrown roots to light your you can light your way with wall torches.
We could certainly add some elements.
We certainly can, though. We'd like this to be a fairly useful training dungeon, so requiring the player to bring a whole bunch of fire making equipment and maybe a pocket full of logs might not help there.
I wouldn't have it everywhere, maybe just one or two little areas, and I'd make it a one-off thing. Mm. But given that we're planning on doing the Winter Todd skilling boss that's kind of heavy on fire making.
Harpy bugs. You need fire making and that lantern to kill the weird harpy bug thing. But if we had, you know, overgrown harpy bugs down a hole, and you actually needed fire making to light something a bit more elaborate to kill them, maybe there'd be a use to harpy bugs.
Maybe you just set them all on fire and just get rid of all harpy bugs.
you want to make harpy bugs extinct?
Yes.
That's really genocide, annoying. Chris.
All right.
Maybe not.
Okay. Ben asks, thoughts on making the crystal bell revert back to a seed upon death in the wilderness? This will stop people from ragging, as it will happen even with protect item on. We kind of said this, I think, last week, maybe 2 weeks ago.
We focused mostly on ideas that would give the PKS something, as well as making the dead person lose some stuff. This would make the dead person lose some stuff, but would not help the PKS so much. That said, having it revert to seed is thematically appropriate, if that's a word.
Yeah.
Like a lot of these people have multiple crystal bows. I
really like this idea as a PKer, personally. Also, there have been many suggestions, or requests rather, to buff the crystal bow, and this opens that up if we wanted to do so.
Yeah. But I think so it's quite easy to do.
Really help with the ragging.
I think if we did change it, they'd just switch to something else expendable, like a magic short bow and some iron arrows.
That takes a lot more hassle, I think. It's not as good. I don't know. I'm gonna fight for that one. I like that one. You Never Learn asks, when will we learn the dates for the next Dead Man tourney?
Oh, that player again, huh?
Next Dead Man tournament, we will learn that at the Summer Summit.
What's the date for the Summer Summit?
Next Saturday?
Of May. Next Saturday.
Yeah.
Mm. And for those that don't know, what is the Summer Summit?
For those at Summer Summit, it is a stream where we will be talking to you from all sorts of our different games, so from Chronicle, from RuneScape, about what's coming up over the summer and some of the things. We're going to be looking at the results from the survey that we did, so we're going to be taking that information through as well.
Yes, and data.
Yeah, I've got data. I won't be here doing it because I'm actually on holiday. So it'll be Chris and Ronan who will be showing.
Conveniently.
It's quite ironic because we're planning this, and when we were planning it, they're saying, right, we need to make sure we get the staff involved and get everybody involved that needs to be involved, and everyone's up for it and excited and what have you. And it's like, that's fine, you know, we'll just get the right people involved. So we plan to do it on the 28th of May, and I'm like, yeah, I'm on holiday. So I'll get Chris and Ronan to do it then.
Well, I guess that's three people won't be at the Cambridge Beer Festival.
Yes, yeah. But yeah, so tune in. 5 p.m. BST it starts. There will be lots of talk about stuff that's going on and all the results from the survey that you've just filled in, and that's some interesting stuff in there, which is good.
Yep. So very interesting stuff in there.
Well, we haven't been able to reveal the date for the Dead Man, so you have kind of just confirmed that will definitely be another one.
Oh yeah, I think we all know there's definitely going to be another Dead Man.
Well, I thought that, but the players don't seem to know, because there's only like 25 people currently playing Dead Man, and given the nature of Dead Man, if it was so quiet and there was a huge cash prize at the end of it, I would take advantage of the fact no one's playing it and start playing.
I think there's about 3,000 a day that play it. So there's plenty of people around who still log in, which is great. And the fascinating thing about Dead Man as well is, you know, out of you know, all the players that joined, and we're talking tens and tens of thousands of players joined, 66% of them are still playing RuneScape. They tried Dead Man Mode and then went and thought, oh, I'm enjoying this, although I've been killed a few times, but I want to do this long term, so I'm going to play RuneScape. They logged into Old School and they've been playing that ever since.
That is really good to see.
It is you know, hugely popular. It's wonderful.
Is your daily dose of data from Mod Matt K? Speaking of Dead Man, we've actually got a couple of really cool updates to come with the next season. Obviously, we're looking at the Grand Exchange. I'm looking at a few other options as well. Popular request from you guys. So, should be a really nice start. Moving on. Jay asks, high experience but non-profit hunter method that has been mentioned coming in Zaya Batch 2. Discuss, please.
We were looking at offering a load of other sort of side pieces of content with the raids launch in Zaya Batch 2. We decided to wind that back and just focus solely on raids because there's going to be, you know, another batch of Zaya content. I think we're looking at January 2017 for that. Mm-hmm. That has I think it was Amrit hunting was the brief that you came up with.
Can't remember.
It was designed to be like a sort of high level non-profit, a decent XP per hour of hunting activity.
Oh, that word, the one that looks like armpit hunting.
I can't remember.
I like the idea of high experience but non-profit. But if it's non-profit, that means that whatever you're hunting, you don't keep. So,
or it's just useless.
Or it's useless.
Well,
okay.
I'm sure we can achieve that.
That's actually a nice segue into Ian's sneak peek of the week, I guess, because this.
Yeah.
I mentioned it on Twitter of maybe coming out today. Unfortunately, it couldn't quite be ready, so it's going to be coming out next week. But for a load of the maniacal monkeys that were sort of left in Crux Lair in Monkey Madness 2. Karam, the 10th squad for the last couple of weeks, has been investigating how he can sort of, you know, hunt them and trap them without actually, you know, killing them. And that
spoiler.
That's not much of a spoiler. I think it's fine. And yeah, this is the content that Ian has been working on for this week, and he's now going to preview what it is.
There we go. Hi, everyone. Okay, so beautiful segue from John there. It's been 10 years since I've looked at this code, but we're now looking at an addition to the Hunter skill, so let's hope this all works out properly. To be honest, there's also some brilliant mechanics in Monkey Madness 2 that we just really wanted to reuse, but spoiler warning, if you haven't played Monkey Madness 2, you might want to look away now. For this, we are going to need some bananas, so let's make some of those. And we're going to need our crook, Grigri. And then we're going to head back to where the airship was during the quest. We'll now see that the airship has gone. And in its place, it's swarming with these maniacal monkeys. And a whole load of boulders, so you can probably guess what's going to happen. This happens quite a lot in our game, apparently. Boulders, innocent animals, death and destruction. Now, if I try to lift the boulder myself, I get told it's too heavy. Maybe I can find someone to help me, or something. And over here, we've got our poor, stunted, demonic gorillas, which we can climb aboard. Now, if we head over to one of these rocks, place a banana underneath, step back, and hopefully one of these monkeys will be tempted enough to actually go for it. Come on, little monkeys. Oh, there goes one. There we go. He's going for it. He's got it. Oh no! And he's left his tail behind. So we go over here and we look under this rock, we can see there's a tail underneath. We take that out. Now, the tail we've actually picked up there is just part of a monkey's tail. So these you'll be able to skin using a knife to make sinew for making crossbow strings with. There will be a very rare chance of getting an undamaged monkey tail, and then you'll be able to use that for the ballistas. But I must stress that's very rare because we don't want to be clobbering the price of them. it requires level 60 hunter to lay one of these traps, and we're aiming to fill a gap in the XP rate, so it will be best XP rate for a few levels before switching back to chin chompers at higher levels. The tail growing back, yes. So the monkey's tails do grow back. They must have some kind of lizard DNA or something. And they shed the tail. There we go. There's the monkey. He's got no tail there, but there you go. It's growing back in little bits. If you follow him. So don't worry. No monkeys were harmed in the making of this. Well, not permanently. Yeah, there you have it. There's also a ready supply of bones, so if you want to go around turning all your bones into bananas so you can bait more traps, then you can do that as well.
I must say, I really didn't get to see that content until it was just about earlier today, and I was really happy with it.
And that's an awesome animation.
Yeah, some really cool graphics involved in that.
Just one thing real quick. You can only set one trap per person. So don't worry about someone going in and then setting all of the traps and then trying to claim all the spots.
That's the usual rule for Deadfalls, I believe.
Yeah.
I sat in the manager's meeting this Monday morning, and I said, what have you got coming out? I was like, hopefully we've got the monkey stuff coming out, monkey hunting. Yeah. And I'm like, what monkey hunting? It's like, oh, you catch some monkeys and then nick their tails. What? Just leave it there, it's fine.
It certainly beats the suggestion of, you know, pickpocketing, and you try to pick a monkey's pocket, and if you're really skillful, you get the entire monkey's entire backside. The tail just comes away in your hand. That might be a bit too dark.
Yeah, and just to confirm, guys, it's a really super rare chance of actually getting a good monkey tail you can use as part of the ballista. We don't want to be affecting their prices drastically at all.
Yeah. Did we say the level?
It requires level 60 hunter, and we're looking at XP rates that are sort of best for level 60 to the 75 bracket. So, you know, top end XP rates won't be affected at all.
Okay.
But this should be really the place to go for the most efficient journey towards like level 75, level 80.
Awesome. Look forward to that hopefully next week.
Mm. It's also quite AFK, and totally not the reason I decided to come back and finish maxing. Promise.
Someone asked me that on the yesterday. I was like, I
hope
not.
It really wasn't.
All right. Let's see. Which question are we at here? My name is Mo, I believe, here asks, can we get an auto-deliver to bank feature similar to Burt Sand after Artie Elite Diaries for the Pure Essence from Wizard Crumperty?
Crumperty.
That's the one. And Flax after Candor and Elite.
The Pure Essence. Actually, you don't purchase it, do you? Yeah, it could be done. Why not?
It's the staffs where you have to, I think.
Yeah, the staffs are the ones that cost money. I have to pull it, of course. I mean, it looks, actually it's kind of mixed.
EasyScape.
Yeah.
Does that mean, will we have to add a login message when it's been done and then give you a toggle for that login message because you're tired of seeing?
Well, we didn't give them one to Bird.
I think we did, actually.
Did we?
Yeah.
Oh, dear God.
Yeah, I think we did.
Can't players just vote for something without then demanding the rights to get rid of it again?
No, come on, that made things easy.
Yeah. All right, next question.
This is Sarah from Maz in the background.
Because she probably knows she'll be programming it.
Corin Tower asks, will the redwood logs also have a use in fletching and construction for bows and furniture?
No. The lore reason is that they're too strong to be turned into a bow or something.
Oh, man.
Because we don't have space for another bow, and construction just involves an enormous amount of work just to give you the plank, and then we've actually got to give you something that the plank is useful in. That's not to say it won't have future uses, but yeah.
While all these things could be done, it's not obvious that what those skills need is quite that update right at the moment without any pole.
So I don't know if you had any other ideas for them?
Not tying into them skills. No.
It's always good to avoid construction.
Yeah.
Is there anything else they could fletch aside from a bow?
Mm. Crossbow limbs, maybe. Maybe if there's a new tier of crossbow out in the future, dragon crossbow limbs. You don't actually make blackjacks.
Just what you need, more blackjacks.
Yeah. Little stool to sit on.
Javelins.
About mobile furniture, which you can take around. Mm. And
new javelin. Yeah.
It's red.
They're already really good, I'm just kidding.
There must be something we can do with the colour that would be relevant.
I did look at how one would first come up with the idea of using redwood trees, what you can actually do with redwood trees. And to make furniture is effectively the only thing you can do with it. That or just build roads through the middle of them. That was it for redwood trees. Mm.
All right, well, if you have any better ideas, by all means, send them away.
I would like to get them in as a component for some future furniture, especially if we're doing some construction rooms in the summer.
But treehouse. Mm. There Ooh. We go.
That would be pretty cool. We do have a wow. garden.
You've stolen an idea from my woodcutting guild already.
Are we going to do a treehouse?
I was planning on it.
Oh, wow. See, like, one out of, like, yeah. 17 ideas that I just spit out on this Q&A.
Actually, if I can pipe in on the woodcutting guild, I had a great idea for... I had a foundation of a concept that I'd like to offer for some kind of shrine that you offer your god eggs at, because, you know, we have the useless red, green, and blue eggs. I didn't think of it until the day after the poll went up, so we'll stick it on to the next poll. But I have, like, some kind of altar where you offer up your eggs and you get some kind of item in return, thinking maybe a really slim chance at some of the lumberjack pieces and a cool new item that's yet to be defined. Let me know what you guys think, slash give me some ideas for what it can return.
Because how would you like those ideas? Reddit? Twitter.
Ronan, where's the best place to read Twitter. Ideas right now?
Reddit if it actually gets something more.
So that's Twitter.
forums, of course.
Yeah. We do have forums.
We do have forums.
Right, but you can't the good post pictures and...
One of the good things about the new community manager coming in is that we can actually put more attention onto the forums as well, which will be quite nice.
All right. Let's actually go to the next question. It's still relevant. Corin Tower again asks, will the woodcutting guild have flax and spinning wheels available?
Hadn't planned on it, but
I guess
there's
could.
Room for it.
Yeah, makes sense. It's a nice idea.
Okay. Cool.
Also, the spinning wheels of Zaire are not that close to a bank. I think there are some just west of the Hesidius bank, but there could certainly be more.
All right, next question. Blanks asks, similar to the idea of picking up arrows and having them go straight into your quiver if you already have that arrow equipped, can we see the same for runes in the rune pouch?
Oh, I'm going to have so much fun trying to program that.
That would be... it's technically possible. It's just a rather odd and awkward one to actually construct from a development point of view.
It could be done. It's actually not that much harder than doing it to the bolt pouch. The two have a lot of similarities, just less interface.
Just to clarify, guys, essentially if you had blood runes in your rune pouch and then you picked up blood runes, they wouldn't go into your inventory, they would instead go into your rune pouch.
At which point what we'd get is, hey Jagex, I picked up some blood runes, they've gone missing, fix it, and I want 5 more blood runes.
Yeah. I still got bug reports about runite miner's name.
Yeah. Can we change that guy's display name and then change the NPC to match?
We can, actually.
moving on. Well, this paper's not working. FTP asks, thoughts on making a follow-up to Dragon Slayer? Says, Elvarg's head is stolen from Oziak, and a mecha Elvarg is created, a.k.a. Godzilla.
Out of a stolen head.
Necromancy. That makes sense.
Something. Alternatively, you could have some sort of Frankenstein-esque monster that someone's building and has stolen that head for a Frankenstein-esque type monster, and it's turning into this big sort of Godzilla type thing, which they're building out of different parts of different bosses. So, you know, you could just probably use Dagonoth tails or...
That's actually a really cool idea, yeah.
It's evolving into something good. I once bought a game called Killing Zone, which sounded absolutely amazing. Okay, you got all these mythical creatures and you built it together and you trained it to fight in a ring and you fought. It was the worst game in the world, got 2% in PC Gamer. It was a terrible. So the concept's so cool.
Just
sticking all these different, you know, mythical beasts together.
But, like a KBD head on a unicorn.
With no child arms.
Creature Frankenstein Part 2.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It would be certainly more interesting than getting a very large guy who turns out to be a lot more principled than Frankenstein.
Yes, indeed.
All right. Next question is from Catherbay, who asks, can we address Vedion? Currently, the only way even to remotely kill it is by abusing the safe spot. Assuming this wasn't the intention, can the boss have a rework?
In all honesty, I would love to just strip that boss out and start again, as we've done with quite a lot of Mod Reach's content. But it's always difficult to place a boss down in existing map squares.
I know Ghost doesn't like the design too particularly. So
yeah, it's not very pretty.
To be fair, now we've got the ability to get a custom piece design, which we didn't have before.
Yeah, we didn't have artists when we made those bosses, so we just made do with what we had. I'm actually okay with it being something that you just save spot because it's in level 46 wilderness and it's... You know, you take that risk when you go there rather than it being a challenging boss fight, and it still takes a level of skill to get it into position to be able to safe spot it.
If we wanted a boss that couldn't be safe spotted, we'd have to put it in a custom room with suitably straight edges. That's pretty much the only way it's ever been solved.
Or let it wander around the entirety of the wilderness, including Edgeville.
Even then, it would get stuck on ceiling.
Yeah, that's true. All right.
So, the big square rooms, like we did with Scorpia. And... if we were reworking Vettium, we could dig out a hole and stuff him down it, and do much the same to Venonatus. Yes, that one.
Spider boss.
Yes.
Callisto.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Next question then. Armin Dino asks, when will sailing be repulled?
Why is everyone looking at me? It's not in our immediate
process.
A lot of the content that it was going to offer, we've kind of done and actually implemented in various other ways. Like a lot of the rewards, the Zenite jewelry was part of the sailing design. Gemstone dragons were going to be some of the things that dropped those Zenite crystals that you found on an island. So we'd have to come up with some more stuff. But the core skilling concept still exists. I don't think the sentiment towards a new skill has changed enough to warrant repolling it yet. There's no point in polling it, just let it fail. When you are crying out to us for a new skill, we can offer you a new skill.
Mm. And for what it's worth, we just had a meeting discussing some of the biggest updates we want to do for the rest of the year, and there's a lot of massive, really cool, big stuff in there. I'm not sure there's a gap for sailing.
Well, no, certainly not in the summer. Yeah, as Chris was saying yesterday, we are provisionally scheduled all the things we're going to do. We could be focusing on our existing skills quite a lot, and you know, add complementing content to those.
It would be good to flesh out the top ends of the existing skills more before having another one. It was pointed out the other day that there's almost nothing you can get as an advantage from having higher agility over 96.
Well, 96 is still pretty damn
high. It's quite high.
It is pretty high, yes, but then there's still quite a lot of millions of XP to get all the way to 99 for the cape.
There's nothing benefiting you after you've got two fire making, so...
Or actually, you can't do much mana too without that. 60.
Mm. Harpy bug swarms.
And you need, I think, 85 for the infernal tools. So don't tell me there's no content in fire making. There's just very little.
Fair. We've got tons of questions left. A handful will be saved for next week, but we've got a little bit of time, so we're going to try to speed run through as many of these as possible. So let's start with some from the chat real quick here. Ramses asks, will Iron Man get personal charter shops so that we don't have to compete with other Iron Man for soda ash and sand?
We can't actually do personal shops in the old school engine.
And you know what our engine backlog is like.
Okay. That's not a name. That name. Why do play soldiers not work with jewelry teleports like the glory?
Do work to a certain extent. Depends how you want it to work. If they want it to work differently, like similar to potions, then let us know.
Yeah. When we launched it, we said that we could make the things share placeholders, which is what we did at first for jewelry and for potions. Feedback was that people didn't like that behaviour for potions, so we changed it. We said we could change it for jewellery as well. The straw poll was a little bit hand-wavy on that one, so we've left it for now. We are still perfectly happy to change it if people have made up their minds, but it didn't seem to be a very strong preference either way, and no, we're not going to be able to toggle that one, sorry.
All right, Livy2 asks, can you pull having the Dragon Bolt special only be partially negated by anti-fire potions and requiring the shield for full protection? This would give the ACB some viability in PvP, as it's currently quite useless.
I have nothing against polling it. I expect it to fail quite badly. Yeah.
Mm. I have trouble imagining that one passing a poll.
Personally, I would love to see this, I know it's not going to pass.
It's a logical thing to say, isn't it? But change PvP, you're always going to be difficult.
Yeah.
All right. Ultima asks, how plausible would it be to improve the viewing orbs in Clan Wars?
How would they like them improved? Because I actually think they're actually a pretty decent system.
Well, things that we've occasionally wanted, even for our own live streams, included the ability to just decouple the camera from where the player is and have it roam the area freely and let you see what's going on anywhere rather than just the five places where there happens to be a viewing orb put. Now, we talked to another member of the engine team before we had Ian available to us, and he spent a while looking into it, looking at whether he could load map other than where you are and load players and NPCs other than where you are, and concluded that since the entire client had been based around the fact that those were the same place, he pretty much ruled out ever being able to decouple them and have the game load different map and players from the ones standing near you. Now, the good thing is that since then, Ian's been able to do some other work, which we used to launch Zora quite a while ago now, that lets us load players and NPCs further away from where you're standing. I'm not entirely sure what happened if you go and try that in a busy place like Clan Wars, potentially, but even if we couldn't see map very far, we would at least be able to see players and NPCs a bit further from you if we could point the camera in the right directions. The other thing we've got is some slightly more useful features for hiding the player. In theory, we could try and let you roam round and round and round the Clan Wars map freely as a sort of invisible ghost that no one could see, or no one could interact with, no one could attack, and you just follow people around and look at them and see what you like. Of course, there's a lot of difficulties to that, such as what happens if somebody accidentally kills you and you die, or if you get in the battle and skew the results one way or the other. And we've never been confident we could make that happen in Clan Wars without breaking Clan Wars, and we thought we'd better not break Clan Wars for the sake of a more interesting viewing orb. So we've held back from that one. But if that were ever possible, that would probably be the ultimate viewing feature. That's all I know about that.
All right, back to the quickfire questions.
Hey, you asked. You asked quickly.
No.
You responded fairly swiftly.
That's about as good an answer as you're going to get on anything. So, moving on, Calveo asks, can we get an option to price check the herb sack showing its total value?
Probably.
We can't stick a non-tradable item into the price checker as it currently is, but if we added an extra op to the price checker, could make it do the job.
Do it with the gem bag while we're at it.
Can't remember how many ops they've already got, though.
I think there should be one free on the herb bag map. We didn't use all the ops available for the herb sack, did we? I think it's got at least one. Yeah.
Might be in luck there then.
And the gem bag should be the same, because it's got fill and empty.
Okay. Rusps asks, which countries have the most old school players?
America.
Yeah, US and then UK.
US. I could tell this exactly. It goes US, it goes.
Oh, no, you just spoil it. This is my reveal.
Sorry, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
You'll have to reveal something
you'll
else.
We'll find out on the 28th. It's a shock at number 7.
Ooh, that's good. That's good. Strong. You just bought all my viewers back. It's good. You're going to want to stay tuned. It's going to be crazy. Right?
It is crazy. Yeah. I'm an attack helicopter.
basically, we're doing a stream, if you guys missed, next Saturday is the Summer Summit. Ronan and I will be showing you guys some of the data from the survey? Player survey?
Yeah.
So, yeah. There you
what
go.
You think is important and break down all that sort of stuff.
All right. Austin asks, could we see a dust staff dropped from a very high level Slayer monster?
I'd like to offer that at some point. It's just finding the most suitable boss for it, really. It makes sense to stick on a dust devil, actually. It's just popped into my head.
I'd quite like to see it as instead of something solid that you're holding, it's almost sort of ether reel that's sort of made out of dust floating around as a staff. I mean, I'm sure Gareth will crucify me for suggesting.
Yeah, because we don't have any kind of particle effect.
I was going to say, did you just say particles?
Yeah, but you know, Gareth is very clever, so I'm sure he could do it really.
Yeah, I'd actually like to take a moment just to sit right there and tell how I became the prince for a tackle. But just appreciate just how hard it is to be an artist on our team, because we have very little to work with in terms of what our engine is capable of, and some of the awesome graphics that Gareth and Alfie were able to come up with is quite spectacular.
Yeah.
It is wonderful. It is wonderful.
Would they also want a mist staff? I mean, mist is the one we're also missing, I think.
That's
what we like a dust staff, but the other colour.
Yeah.
I'm sure we'll launch the mist devils at some point.
Mist devils.
Water fiends.
Yeah,
people have been asking to buff their drop table. Throw a really rare mist staff on there.
Fog fiends. It matters just time.
Jay Bizzle asks, is it possible to put something similar to Ivy on the walls of the Mage Bank or Deep Wilderness for PKing incentive?
See, this is the thing about these questions, is it misses out the one thing, which is what? What do they want to put on there?
Ivy.
But what's the PK incentive? Because you're just being there with your woodcutting axe.
I think
yeah, so But you're right. You'd only be killing a guy for an axe and like
ivy, which
and he would protect his axe. I think we've proved it's in really 2014 that putting skilling activities in the wilderness is not the way to increase activity in the wilderness.
Right. Sam asks, can we pay the gardeners to clear a fruit tree just like they can with regular trees?
So you don't have to pick the fruit before you can chop it down?
Probably so you don't have to have an axe.
Yeah.
Also, the darn stumps keep going back a bit faster.
They do.
Yes, yes, that can be, well, take a bit of doing, but it can be done.
Okay.
And Maz is the other developer who knows the farming code really well, and we've got her on the team, so that's all right.
Right. OSRS Drummer asks, can we have the option to turn off the high elk warning on certain items like rune chain bodies?
You can turn it off by right-clicking the high alchemy spell, and then just turn it back on once you're done alchemy.
We should dig out that idea I had for letting people customise where the threshold is for it so that they can decide what a high-value item is for themselves and we don't have to think about it again.
That would be nice. I think when we first wrote it, we didn't have the GE, so it's defined by alk value, and that threshold was, I think, 30k, so whatever it alks for, plus 40%. If we defined it by GE value and then gave them that toggle, I think that would be an ideal solution.
And then they could change it whenever they feel like.
Actually, I'm going to jump to the suggestions now, if that's all right, because we're running low on time. So we've just got a few suggestions here. There's typically images with these. They're nice. First one here is from Baratho, who asks, new spell from Arims. There you go. Should I read it?
Yeah, read it. Yeah.
Only can be cast with the Arims staff. Requires 70 magic to cost. Uses 1 blood rune, 5 mind runes. Max hit is 25. When wearing full Arims, the max hit is increased to 30, and with the Amulet of the Damned effect, I can't read the bottom line.
You have 25% chance to save runes.
They can read it. A lot of yeses.
Yeah,
just requires an extra spell to be added to the spell book, which is fine as long as people don't mind the other spells potentially moving to make space for it and things like that.
I think the only one of relevance on the standard spell book would be, assuming it would be on the standard spell book, would be Teleblock.
High Elf as well. Although
you can move items with High Elf.
They are dead to the Barrows Brothers, so maybe Necromancy spell.
That spell book is like tied to.
There's nothing combat in there, though, right?
You'd have to really want that spellbook if you're going to go around with just one spell.
This looks like a purple firewave. At least the animation he gave it is a purple firewave, so or a purple airwave.
Yeah, that's why I was just.
We could give a different animation, though, to be honest. But all right, cool suggestion. Peels asks, inspect option on other players.
So he's inspected the player to see his inventory, or sorry, his gear setup.
Yeah, I mean, RuneScape has an examine feature where you can examine a player and see their, you know, their name, their clan. They can have a custom message from a predefined set of strings, see their stats and what they're wearing, and you can have privacy settings to set that on or off. And I think they have it off by default, so we would do the same. I believe we would need some engine features to make it happen.
Might be a lot there. There may be some spare player ops that we're not using. I can't remember for sure. I don't remember how many we've got exactly or how many we're using, but if there were a spare one, then we could probably do this now.
That's interesting. Can we straw poll that quickly? Because it is quite a contentious one.
Can we throw the image back on screen just for reference? Cool, so we're going to get a straw poll for you guys.
But I would like to reiterate that this would naturally come with privacy settings, so you could disable, we could turn off the ability for other people to examine you.
Yeah, the screen just opens and there's a sign saying, mind your own business.
I think I'd go and buy as many expensive, like, probably onyx bolts, so that when somebody inspects me, they'd be like, whoa, that guy's rich. No?
Or
just wear an Ellie, yeah. All right. That actually would be nice, because there's a couple instances, not me, of course, because I know everything, but you might see a player that looks really cool, and you go, what is that guy wearing? Not me.
Well, you might, someone might have just crashed you at your Blood Veil Slayer spot, and you want to see what their skills are, so you can... It's like, oh, okay, maybe he's better than me, I'll just leave.
Well, what's that thing? It's the shiny new dust staff. That's why it looks like a flock of harpy bugs in a kind of column.
Okay. Panic bionics bolts. Yeah.
That straw poll is now in the chat for you guys. We're actually going to run you through the next suggestion while we wait for you guys to vote. The next one is from Hurricos, who says, Torag's tank shield. Got a little bit of talking with this one. So almost no one uses full Torag's or the weapon, since it has the best overall defense bonuses of any Barrow set. I propose it's turned into a defensive set. Your defense level is boosted by 2/3 your current hit points, You reflect 25% damage you block 70% of the time. And then there's also the Toreg's Bulwark, which is a two-handed shield and weapon with higher defenses than any other shield in the game. It replaces Toreg's hammers in the set and requires 70 strength and defense. Whew.
I always like the idea of a proper tank set.
Yeah, I like the idea. I would want to run those numbers through my balancing spreadsheets before guaranteeing that's how it would work. I think there's definitely merit in the concept. We need to get the numbers right before we can poll that, because I'm seeing a very mixed reaction.
Yeah, and with our combat system, would it end up that someone would just switch to that every time they're about to take a hit? So they'd end up having all these defensive bonuses.
That is very true. It's quite a significant change to the sort of mechanics of PvP.
Could be. Although we could do it so it takes a while to unequip.
Yeah.
I mean, assuming it's going to be relatively expensive in protect item over something that you might want to bring instead of it, right? Mm.
Yeah.
So it sounds good for more PVMing, I would think it'd be used for. I'm not, but personally, the reflecting damage kind of scares me, at least with 25% of 75% of the time. But the two-handed shield sounds really cool.
We'd also need to be able to recalculate your defensive bonuses whenever your hit points change. There's a trigger we can tie into for that, I think. I just don't really want it to get massively inefficient by running all the time for people who are not using this thing. I reckon that's solvable.
Not saying Toreg's is expensive. Toreg's is obviously quite cheap, but it depends where you get this shield from. And
you
I'm
have to
look
at the effect on the Elysium as well. It's
probably expensive by the end of the stream, though, when he starts buying it.
Gosh, the straw balls are getting a bit fancier than they used to be.
So we got the results back from that first straw poll. Would you use the player inspect option? 80% saying yes, a little over 2,000 votes. Thanks, guys.
How long do you think that would take you?
We'd need to convert the existing thing that currently looks at the player who's clicking it to be able to work on a player who's that person over there instead. But I don't see that being too difficult. No, I don't see that being too difficult at all. I wouldn't have seen it as such high priority as some of the other things that they've asked for in this stream even, but...
Oh, no, I'm just wondering if it was one of the things that we could sort of just tack on to a quality of life poll.
We just have to make sure that there's a spare player option that we can tie into. Like you said, if there isn't, we would need engine stuff. Yeah. But we might be in luck. Or we could just use one of the options that isn't in use for other things all the time, like pelting with snowballs, whacking with a rubber chicken. If you've got those items equipped, then maybe you don't see this option because
it's
useless. But if you want to go around inspecting people, I'm afraid you'll have to put your little rubber chicken away in your pocket to be able to do it and get the inspect option back again.
Nice. So maybe see that on a poll in the near future, TM.
Depends what else they come up with and whether it would be more beneficial to them or at least more interesting. But I don't mind the idea at all.
Yeah, it is a cool idea. Okay, guys, that's going to just about... We have 2 minutes left. You know what? Let's sneak in another question or two. Where were we? Ben asks, are you considering releasing old usernames anytime soon?
We have... Display name thing has now passed. Using bonds for display name, isn't it? So I was chatting with the player support team earlier about whether we could look at releasing them. There are challenges ahead if we need to release them or we can release them. But they're challenges we will look into. I don't know if we can solve them. We've done it in the past, but the system that did that doesn't work anymore, so we need to figure out how to do that. So if we can, we will. If we can't, we can't, but we will investigate that.
Okay. One last one then, shall we? I'm actually going to hop to one here down the list, so don't worry about the on-screen question. Let's see here. These might be actually good. This one from Aerolter asks, what content dev is working on the Clue Scroll expansion?
That would be Kieran's first major project once he's finished his training, which he is going through at the minute with Maz. I expect he'll have a little support as well from one of the other devs, which will probably end up being Maz herself. But yeah, that's Kieran's.
With graphics from Mod Ghost, which some of you have seen on previous live streams.
Yes, yeah, sneak peeks of the week over the next month or so will almost entirely be Clue Scrolls, I imagine.
What? Not sure what the spamming wrong
it
for.
It will splash a different question on the screen, maybe.
Maybe.
For about a second.
That's right. Okay, just to follow up from that, do you think we can fit this in? Actually, it's over. I don't care. He had a follow-up question asking, what's the difference between a junior, regular, and senior content developer?
Anyone know?
Right, well, a junior, right, okay. So we have, that works here, we have junior content developer, lead content developer, and principal content developer. Your junior is somebody who's just started off, generally doesn't have any experience in content development in the industry. They probably have qualifications, but they need to get to a stage where they're comfortable developing on their own, and you're able to give them projects and they'll run with them. You then get content developer, which is that level of person. So effectively, you can give them a project, they will run off with it, they will keep doing it, and they will make good content. You then get your lead content developer, and your lead content developer is somebody who manages a team of content developers. So they may well be a good content developer in themselves, but they don't have to be. They have to be a good manager. So they basically take care of a group of content developers.
You then get your... Not necessarily anymore. I think leads more leaning towards someone that you go to for experience and advice.
That's what the principal was. Mm.
Well, the funny thing is, who runs the team?
We don't know.
It's actually you.
Yes, exactly, yeah. Not in our team, because we don't have any lead content developers yet, but we will at some point have a lead content developer.
I think Maz is actually.
Is you?
Yeah, Maz is one.
Shows how much I know.
It's not what we use it for.
And then principal, which is what Ash, which is a super good content developer who's there to be mentored to other.
Yeah. But nobody expects me to have management skills.
Yes. So it's almost like two different directions, which is one has the management side of it, the other one has the pure content side of it. So you get principal and lead that way.
But it does incorporate experience both ways.
But there's a lot of changes to how the structure works. It'll probably be changed again by the time the new content developer starts, if we get another one.
Well, it's changed over the years. Yeah. One of the main criteria is, at what point could Jagex say, all right, you go develop this big project without us needing to hold your hand all the time, and the more challenging projects you can reasonably take on without needing support, or projects where you end up having to direct other people in other teams to get the whole project together, that's the kind of way you might see yourself proceeding up the ranks.
All right, good question, actually. Yeah. Haven't asked that one before, which is sometimes difficult to say. Aside from that, that's going to about conclude the Q&A. Again, Ian previewed the monkey hunting earlier in the Q&A. If you missed that, the highlight will be up on YouTube.
I'll be out next week.
And the update will be out next week. Cool. Give the stream a follow if you enjoyed. Give the video a like if you enjoyed. Aside from that, guys, thank you for watching. We'll catch you next week.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.